please silence all electronic devices, refrain from using flash photography, and remain silent until you hear applause. Thank you and enjoy the performance.
Thank you. Thank you, David Brooks, for having me, and for everyone here at Wingate who's been so welcoming. Is just walking around town today, enjoying the beautiful weather and seeing the sights. And I look forward to meeting some of you in the coming days. So this is my Americans in, around, inspired by, you name it, Paris program, working title. And so it's all about the influence of Paris and, well, France in general on American music and also just some of the most famous French music that everyone knows. So I'll start, I guess, with another prelude. And so this is Debussy's version of the prelude, Debussy being one of the most famous French composers, most influential. And I would say that the prelude in general was inspired by Bach. So it goes all the way back to, you know, the 16th century. 16th century. I get those mixed up. Actually, the 17th century. And so the genre, it's basically just whatever you want it to be, a very short, confined work. And Debussy actually puts kind of programmatic titles. So he kind of tells a story through this piece. And this one is about, it's an ancient myth about a cathedral which is submerged in water and only arises at dawn on some clear days for a very brief moment of time. And so there are a number of things that kind of represent this through the music. And one just goes, you know, back to Gregorian chant. You hear a lot of fourths and fifths, those intervals. So in Gregorian chant, you would have something like that, and then it would be harmonized. In these intervals. And so he puts a lot of that in there, and then the main thing that you'll hear is when the cathedral arises. There's this big buildup, and it's these big chords. At the very end, you also hear, see if you can hear it. You can hear this, the cathedral being submerged in water yet again. So this is Debussy's prelude. And I'm also running a camera production here, so pardon me while I turn them off and on. Thank you. Romanticism in general, Franz Liszt, one of the greatest pianists of all time, probably, but much more than that, he really took the piano literature to a new level. Liszt believed so firmly in the piano and in its ability, its expressive ability, and also the ability of the human hand to do abnormal and insane things. And so this kind of was coming from his own personality, but it was really inspired to the fullest extent when he heard Paganini, the great violinist, in around 1834 in Paris. And so Paganini, it's hard to like overestimate the influence that he had on the Romantics. I mean, he not only played the violin better than everyone else, he played it in a way that no one had been thought possible. And when Liszt heard Paganini, he heard his destiny. And he sought to create these same effects, the same excitement, and the same virtuosity on the piano, which was now ready for that. Because before, even with Beethoven and with Mozart, any of you who have played his sonatas or heard his music for the piano, he didn't have the full range of the instrument. He didn't have the iron frame that you see in every piano today. He didn't have all the little intricacies in the action, which enable even faster playing. So, so the time was ripe for Liszt, and he took it. And so these are two of his transcendental etudes, really the kind of response to hearing Paganini. They're two of the hardest pieces that you could possibly play, probably. And particularly the first one has this reputation for being like the hardest piece in the literature. I mean, it's all subjective, of course. But, so I invite you to come along with me with my journey of trying to play this piece. Each performance is a little bit of a Mount Everest, I don't know. But I keep trying and trying to get to a new level. So a tradition I have is actually always recording the performance on my phone, so I keep them all right here to see what I did wrong the next day. So here we go. Say a prayer for me. You can also say hello to the phone. I got it facing the wrong way. There we go. It's gonna help. It's not gonna help my playing, but. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I think there's a reason for that. It's one of the most evocative descriptions of moonlight in music, I think, maybe ever composed. It's not just how it evokes moonlight. It's about all the feelings that moonlight maybe represents, and that kind of strange light also that the moon has, and the night in general, and romance and all those things. It's in a major key, but there's also tones of darkness in it. And if you listen to the melody as it begins, you don't know what key it's in, actually, until you get here. So you have this. And so the next time, the last time you hear this melody, there's a note, there's one more note that he adds, and I want you to listen to it and see if you think, if you know what it might mean, for you. When it comes back, it's different because, when we return to something else, we're not the same person who maybe experienced that the first time. And so it's one of the ways that Debussy kind of captures that essence, the essence of that feeling. So here it is. Thank you. most famous French composer, warring French composer. Ravel's, I mean, and they're both considered impressionist composers, a title which they both kind of disliked. And, which I guess basically just means that you're, like, trying to conjure up impressions of things. And maybe that's true, or maybe it isn't. Even Debussy's Prelude that I play, he puts the titles at the end of the piece instead of the beginning, saying that, you know, the music should speak to you no matter what. And Ravel's style is a little bit more direct, maybe, and he was also influenced by, well, there are so many different cultural influences in Paris during the later 19th century, and especially early 20th century, and one of them was Spanish music. And so this kind of goes directly with that inspiration. Alvarado del Gracioso is called it's like the morning song of the jester. And so you hear this kind of guitar-like figures in the beginning, and even there's really fast repeated notes that are kind of hard to play. So, but it's, you know, has to do with that style of playing on the guitar. And in the middle is the song. And so you have this kind of really expressive melody with an eerie kind of accompaniment going on around it. It's a very orchestral piece for the piano, and later on, Ravel did orchestrate it. He was one of the greatest writers for orchestra, and it's hard to listen to anything else after you listen to orchestral version of this, because it's so amazing, so colorful, but I'll see what I can do.
Thank you.
So, we come to the end. This is an arrangement that I, well, not really an arrangement, a transcription that I made of one of Gershwin's greatest works, I believe. It's a big orchestral work. And I feel like it works pretty well for the piano if you have like 20 fingers. So. You know, I have 10, so I have to do what I can, but each time I play it, I kind of like put in more notes, so this is the latest conglomeration. And it's a great work, because Gershwin had gone to Paris to study with Ravel, the last composer, and he was really obsessed by the music of Ravel. He loved the color, like, of course, his orchestration, and you hear that in the orchestral version of this, like, a really colorful orchestration. And while he was there, he also took lessons from one of the great French composition teachers who was responsible for so many American composers, Nadia Boulanger. And so he took lessons with those two composers. And Ravel really didn't know what to do with it. And Nadia Boulanger said something that was very astute. She said that, why do you want to become a second-rate Ravel when you can become first-rate Gershwin? And certainly in this piece that he did become a first-rate Gershwin, it's kind of a story. It takes you on a journey of like someone who would be visiting Paris. And so you hear in the beginning like the hustle and bustle of the street. He even brought back taxi horns to be used in the orchestra for the piece. So you hear a lot of this kind of, that kind of represents taxi horns. And then there are, you know, a few other things in there. There's a blues section in the middle. It's very, one of his greatest things. Very romantic. And then it kind of goes back to previous material. And near the end, there's this kind of ragtime element thrown in as well. So, and all these themes kind of go through their own transformations. And so you'll hear that. And yeah, it's just, I invite you to take a journey with me to Paris, via Gershwin.
Thank you. Thank you.